Fire it all.
Hey, look who's back. Sitting here, jamming to Mr. Worldwide. We're trying to figure out if he's gonna truly spread communism worldwide. Continue our adventure with the stages of the Cold War. Alright, Mr. Fireball, you gotta go away. Okay, so I want to pick up where we left off yesterday, or the last time you watched the video. And so we were exploring some of the early episodes of the Cold War. Remember, this is an ideological war that's taking place between the Soviet Union, Western Europe, and the United States. So we're going to take a look at the early stages, pushing right into the 1960s. So really, the 1950s and the 1960s, some of these early events in the Cold War. And the reason I'm taking a little bit of time on this is because it really sets the stage for the Cold War. But we're also going to start to see some of the issues and developments within the Soviet Union that will eventually lead to its decline. So, sit back, take a look. I think it's over here. Hit double speed if you want to go fast, or keep me on regular speed, and away we go. So yesterday we talked a little bit about these two sides. You should have in your notes, if you are caught up and staying on your calendar, which I recommend that you do, then you will know by the 1950s, most European countries were committed to one side or the other. And I want you to be able to think back, what were these two major treaty organizations, a new form of alliances that emerge in the world by the 1950s? What were these two treaty organizations that split up Europe and the world? Are you thinking about them? Got them on the tip of your tongue? Good. Then you know we're speaking of NATO and the Warsaw Pact. If you take a look at here, the countries in blue, got a little chicken scratch, not quite sure what's going on there. But you'll see the North Atlantic Treaty Organization is going to be dominated by the United States, but you will notice pretty much all of the Western European countries are finding themselves into this alliance. Now let's think back to the conversation that we had about alliances before we went into World War I. What is the good purpose, or what is a purpose of a good alliance? It's obviously to try to prevent war. But think about the economic situation for Europe after World War II. You know that most of these countries over here are devastated by the war. We also know that the United States emerges out of World War II as an economic superpower. So, for countries like Iceland and Italy and Luxembourg and the Netherlands and Portugal and really even France and Great Britain, it makes sense for them to join an alliance with the superpower of the United States. Understanding that we got this conflict with the Soviet Union, their ever desire to spread communism worldwide, so they kind of latch on to the United States. The other side is obviously the Warsaw Pact, the communist version of NATO. Much fewer countries, but a big chunk of Europe, all the way stretching into Asia. You will notice the countries here are the countries that were acquired and really put into the Soviet Union on the eastern side of that Iron Curtain. Really like the map that your book has, and explain this. So if we take this into the 1950s and we take a view looking straight down on the globe from the North Pole, really like how you see that this world is now split up into two major treaty organizations with NATO and the Warsaw Pact. But then you will also notice the Middle East finds itself into a pact, and then Southeast Asia is a part of CETO. And so by the 1950s, most of our countries in the world are finding themselves into one alliance or the other. Now, this alliance, as we will get into here shortly, because of the threat of nuclear warfare, these alliances really do the job of a good alliance system, and they do prevent thermonuclear war throughout the course of the Cold War. We will see hotspots, as you notice, on the map, right? We are going to have hot episodes in the Cold War, but we will not have any full-out war between NATO and the Warsaw Pact. The other thing I want you to notice on this map are these countries that are not a part of NATO or the Warsaw Pact. And this is really where we get the term third world countries. If we were in class, we'd have a conversation about, if I asked you what a third world country, describe a third world country to me, most of you would probably bring things up such as, hey, not a technologically advanced, maybe not as industrialized, maybe not as medically, educationally advanced as some of the other countries. Really, where that phrase third world country comes in is the competition between the Warsaw Pact and NATO for countries that have not latched onto an alliance. So these countries in Africa, the countries in Central America and South America, there really kind of is that third world. NATO, Warsaw Pact, first and second world, everybody else is in the third world. So the competition between these countries to gain influence is going to be another major part of the Cold War. As I start going through some of these events, this is the big question that I want you to be really comfortable answering by the time we're done with this unit. And I throw it at you now, because I want it in the back of your head. We're going to go through some of these key events in the 1950s and the 1960s. But as I said earlier, we're starting to build some of the problems that will eventually lead to the downfall of Soviet communism. So I kind of want this question in the back of your head. What led to the collapse of Soviet communism? And was the NATO, the Western European, the United States policy of containment responsible? Or was it more internal problems within the Soviet Union? Talked a little bit about it yesterday. Here's this big focus question that I want you to keep in the back of your brains as we go forward. Okay, so let's dive into some of these major events. I don't think we can really fully talk about the Cold War unless we talk about Iowa. Stalin is out. Dies. The next Soviet leader to emerge is Nikita Khrushchev. Nikita Khrushchev is this funny little man who we'll talk a little bit about a little bit later. He's got a fiery temper. The United States, Western Europe, doesn't know much about him. We'll try to test him a little bit, but he will pull some early actions within the Soviet Union that really make him a threat to the Western European world. But a little side story, in Coon Rapids, Iowa, you're probably wondering where Coon Rapids, Iowa is. It's this little town right here where it's marked on the map. In Coon Rapids, Iowa is a farmer. We will call him Farmer Garst. Farmer Garst owns a seed company. Farmer Garst has been reading about things that are happening within the Soviet Union. He reads a report about the Soviet Union maybe struggling to feed its people. So Farmer Garst, good Iowa man, decides, hey, here in Iowa, we can grow corn. We can grow the best corn in the world. I'm going to write a letter to Nikita Khrushchev and let him know about Iowa corn. So he writes his letter, says, hey, Nikita, here you got some problems growing corn. We got Iowa corn. Let's chat. Next thing you know, Nikita writes back to Khrushchev. We get a farmer in Iowa becoming a pen pal to the leader of the evil Soviet Empire. Next thing you know, they're kind of BFFs, writing back and forth, exchanging some ideas, right? A lot of people in the United States State Department are unaware that Farmer Garst is even communicating with Nikita Khrushchev. So, the United States, offering a goodwill adventure, sends a note to the new leader of the Soviet Union. Hey, Nikita Khrushchev, we would love for you to visit the United States. Nikita responds back and says, okay, you evilest capitalist pigs, I'm going to come for a visit, but I've got a couple of demands. I know when I come there, you're going to make me meet with your politicians and kind of go through the pomp and circumstance, but I'd really like to visit two places. I want to go to Disneyland, which just opened in California, and I want to go to Coon Rapids, Iowa, and meet Farmer Garst. State Department's like, well, we can understand. Disneyland, I mean, come on, happiest place on earth. But who the heck is in Coon Rapids, Iowa? Where the heck is Coon Rapids, Iowa? And so this big updo, and sure enough, right, by the time they do all the plans, they say, okay, we'll let you go to Coon Rapids, Iowa. Side note, they don't let them go to Disneyland. Who knows? We could have ended the Cold War right then had we let the dictator of the Soviet Empire go to the happiest place on earth. But that's a story for a different time period. So, Nikita Khrushchev, in September of 1959, comes to the United States, eventually finds his way to the Des Moines airport, lands in Des Moines, stays overnight in Des Moines, travels up to Ames, takes a tour of Iowa State, their agricultural program. But then the highlight of his trip to the United States clearly was when he arrived in Coon Rapids, Iowa. And I love this quote that he has where he says, before arriving here, I had a picture of Mr. Garst's good farm from accounts and films. I've known Mr. Garst for years. However, it is always better to see than to hear. Let us exchange experience. This will be useful to our countries. So this is a big deal for the state of Iowa. Here you have the Soviet premier on a farm. He has a big old time. He has a great old time traveling with Farmer Garst here. He's completely annoyed by the American press. At any chance that he can, he was reeling. Here he is getting ready to chuck corn at the press. I think at one point he's traveling through a cornfield and he's just picking things up, throwing them at the press any chance he gets. So he spends overnight in Farmer Garst's town, spends some goodwill time with him, eats a hot dog, right? Just has a grand old time. So there's Iowa making a dent in the Cold War. By the way, that corn that Farmer Garst promised him never quite really took off and probably didn't do what we were really hoping to do. But interesting side note, in the Cold War, I can guarantee you this will not be on the AP exam, but good Iowa history, we can't really grasp European history unless we can make a connection to the good old state of Iowa. Remember World War I? First U.S. soldier killed. Now here we are in the Cold War. One of the very earliest episodes of the Cold War, and Iowa is connected. The Cold War is dominated by the nuclear arms race. We know that the United States brought us into the atomic age with the dropping of the bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The Soviet Union followed up and joined the arms race when they exploded their first atomic bomb in 1949. By the 1950s, technology has advanced. Both sides have hydrogen bombs. We pushed through the end of the 1950s into the 1960s, and now both countries will have thermonuclear weapons. Both sides, by the middle of the 1960s, have weapons to absolutely destroy the Earth. When we push into the 1970s and the 1980s, we now can destroy the Earth multiple times. So, this crazy arms race, this ever desire, think back to World War I when we talked about the militarism, this ever desire, this paranoia to think that the other side has more nuclear weapons than you do, really drives the foreign policy of both of these world powers. when your country's in NATO or your country's in the Warsaw Pact, you know, if you're Luxembourg, if you're Norway, if you're those countries, hey, let's let the United States do the heavy lifting with building a nuclear arsenal. We will be protected as far as this alliance is concerned. France, Great Britain, they're going to get their own nuclear weapons as it goes through, but they're tied really tight within NATO, within the alliances. So this arms race really does become MAD. This acronym of MAD stands for Mutually Assured Destruction. The agreement between NATO and the Warsaw Pact basically boils down to this. If one country launches one nuclear weapon against the other country, that country will then respond by launching all of their nuclear weapons. Once that country launches all of their nuclear weapons, the other side will respond by launching the remaining. The remaining supply of their nuclear weapons. End result, destruction of the world. So if both sides know that, if both sides are assured of the fact that one weapon leads to the detonation of all weapons, therefore, common sense should prevail that no one country will launch a weapon. So how do you win a war like that? Well, you play the ultimate game of chicken, and that's known as brinkmanship. The willingness of each side to go to the brink. I'm going to push you right to the edge, and I'm going to make you think that I might push that button. Just get you to the point where those leaders are like, well, maybe they are just crazy enough to destroy the world to make their point. This is what is really going to drive and really keeps the world under this nuclear umbrella and really adds the uncertainty that is the 1950s, the 1960s, the 1970s, and the 1980s. That threat of nuclear warfare, that threat of worldwide destruction really is a heavy cloud that hangs over the world. I can tell you from experience, I grew up in the 80s. I can remember being in elementary school, really fearful that the Soviet Union was going to launch a nuclear attack on us, right? That was just the reality of life in the Cold War. You just always knew that it was a possibility. It truly was a mad time. There are a couple episodes that really drove this to reality. Another key episode of the Cold War that really frightened a lot of Americans was the Soviet Union beating us in the early space race with their launching of an unmanned satellite known as Sputnik across the world. We now know that Sputnik didn't do much other than fly around the world, but it had blinking lights and a keen eye could see this. It scares the hell out of people in the United States and Western Europe, because if the Soviet Union could put a satellite into space, what else could they put into space? What if the Soviet Union gains all of space, right? So a new space race emerges, which will dominate the Cold War. Especially, you'll get into this more within the United States, your U.S. history class next year. But this is a really early victory for the Soviet Union by beating the United States and Western Europe into space. They've got the technological edge. It'll do much. This one event probably does more to change the American education system of anything as we now push into this early STEM efforts, more science, more math. We've got to catch up. We got to put a man into space. This will drive us to put a man on the moon, right? Our efforts to go into space to put a man on the moon, that is a Cold War endeavor. Speaking of the United States and fear, there is a communist revolution that breaks out within the Soviet Union, within Cuba, that the Soviet Union is totally going to support. Now, this is another major fear because now you have a Soviet ally about 90 miles from the coast of the United States. Right? Now it's really hitting home. we don't necessarily talk too much about the fact that we have Western democracies and NATO countries on the actual border of the Warsaw Pact countries in Europe and in the Middle East. But for the United States, this was a big deal, right? Here you get old lovely Nikita giving old Fidel Castro a big old bear hug, right? Gets cut off here a little bit, but what that says, the Cuban Communist Revolution of 1959, it gains the full support of the Soviet Union, right? So that effort, that worldwide effort, is now seeming to hit home a little bit more. I may have said in the earlier video, one of the major ways that you fight a Cold War, other than full-fledged warfare, is through spying. And this was an ideological competition. We are using all sorts of espionage and spying. And one of the major events, another early event that happened, that was another kind of victory for the Soviet Union, was when the Soviet Union successfully shot down one of our U-2 spy planes. We had these spy planes that we thought could fly at high altitudes, take all sorts of pictures, and we thought that they were beyond range of any anti-aircraft weapons that the Soviet Union had. In May of 1960, we found out to that not to be true. And a missile shot down our plane. It landed. The Soviet Union contacts us, says, "We have one of your planes." We're like, "No, that's not one of ours. We would never do such a thing." Next thing you know, they put this pilot on TV, and we have to kind of say, "Oh, that guy." And so it's a kind of an interesting story. Gary Powers, Francis Gary Powers, when he was shot down, American pilots carried poison with them, and he was supposed to poison himself before so he could not be captured alive, but he didn't do it, and so he was captured alive, ends up being a big black eye on the United States and the international world, because here we're, you know, spying on the Soviet Union. They can take the high road, we're down on the low road, and so it's kind of an interesting story. Pretty fascinating. It's also portrayed in a really pretty good movie known as The Bridge of Spies. If you're looking for some good Cold War movie that's not The Hunt for Red October, which, by the way, is not historically accurate, but it hands down the best Cold War movie ever made, and you want to watch something based on a true story with Tom Hanks, take a look. See if you can stream it on any of those devices. I know it's on Amazon Prime. I think this one might say it's like $9.99, but I saw it yesterday. You can rent it for $2.99. Pretty good movie. Pretty dry, not a lot of action, but really gives you a good glimpse of the espionage within the Cold War. Another early event of the Cold War is this sit down between our new young president, John F. Kennedy, and Nikita Khrushchev in Paris of 1961. And this is a really disastrous summit for JFK. He was pretty unprepared. And Khrushchev kind of had his way with him as far as just the debate or his concern. So Khrushchev left this meeting thinking that JFK was young, inexperienced, and somebody that he could kind of push around. As a result of this, we get the Berlin Wall going up. And this is an event that I want you to be pretty familiar with. The Berlin Wall will become the ultimate symbol of the Cold War. We talked yesterday about the Iron Curtain. Now you actually have a physical Iron Curtain, right? The wall that splits Berlin and surrounds West Berlin. It's about 110 miles worth of a wall structure. You're going to read a little bit about this in your notes. I think you should be able to answer these questions pretty comfortably. What was Khrushchev's motivation? Why did he build this wall? This wall takes Berlin by surprise. Many people on the West Berlin just woke up one morning to this construction noise, and their city is being divided. Why does Khrushchev do this? If you pick up some things in your notes, what you would answer that with was to stop the brain drain. What Khrushchev and what the East Germans were starting to realize, that some of the brightest of the bright people in East Germany were fleeing to West Germany. They see the economic, social development that's occurring in the western part of Berlin as an avenue for a much better life. And so the East Germans and the Soviets and Khrushchev fear this brain drain. If we lose the best of the best, what are we going to be stuck with? So basically what we have is an ending of all easy travel between the East and the West. And it really is meant to keep his people in. This is an important event that will help you answer that question. Right? So this is in 1961. In 1961, if people already in 1961 are seeing that the Western world offered them a better future, what can we learn? What does that tell us about life within the Soviet Union? How will that progress over the rest of the 60s, into the 70s, into the 80s? How will this build internal pressure that will eventually lead to the collapse of communism? Right? The Berlin Wall, we'll come back to it at the end of the Soviet Union. When the wall comes down, right? If this is our symbol of the Cold War, then of course we're going to return to it in 1989 when the wall comes down as the sign that the Cold War is over and really the beginning of the end of the Soviet Union. Probably one of the most famous parts of the Berlin Wall is Checkpoint Charlie, which I believe is about basically somewhere right in here. And this was the part where anybody, any international, this was the only way, for example, if somebody from the United States was in West Berlin and they wanted to go to East Berlin, then all international people had to check through Checkpoint Charlie, right? That becomes one of the more famous checkpoints within the Cold War. The most intense event that occurs during the Cold War is the Cuban Missile Crisis. We just talked a little bit earlier. You have Cuba within a spitting distance, it seems, of the United States, now a communist country. Well, the Soviet Union is going to use its ally, now a new member of the Warsaw Pact, and take a look and let's amp this Cold War up a little bit. And so the Soviet Union starts to, with his new ally, Fidel Castro, makes a plan to put some nuclear weapons on the island of Cuba. United States spy planes, through its reconnaissance of a communist country, you know that we've been spying on this country and keeping a smart eye. When we start taking a look at some of the film that was developed, we see what we clearly know are launching bases, missile pads being constructed. And so what begins, what is known as the 13 days. This is a 13-day event. This is brinkmanship. This is a perfect example of that brinkmanship. Khrushchev, remember, he kind of thinks that he can push JFK around. You'll get more into it with your U.S. history, but JFK tried to lead a kind of a secret coup to try to take out Castro. It's known as the Bay of Pigs. It's a complete failure. JFK goes on television. He publicly takes credit for this failure. And so internationally, Khrushchev thinks, hey, I could push this guy around. So let's amp it up a little bit. And let's start making plan to put nuclear weapons on this. This is where JFK starts to show a little bit more of some true Cold War leadership. And we now know, most people were unaware of it at the time, because we really don't know exactly what's happening within our government. Most government records, when a president leaves office, they're sealed for 50 years. Well, we're clearly past 50 years, so historians have now been able to go in and really start looking at the documents that explain what was happening during the Cuban Missile Crisis during this 13 days in October of 1962. And we can now say, with some historical accuracy, that this is probably the closest that we ever came to nuclear war. JFK was prepared to launch a nuclear attack to stop Khrushchev. We put up a naval blockade, and we're basically telling Khrushchev, we know there are ships coming. We know these ships have nuclear weapons on them. You got to turn them around. If you blow this blockade and you do not let our naval ships stop you, then I'm going to launch a nuclear weapon, right? And so through these negotiations, Khrushchev gets pushed to the brink. And lucky for the world, he makes the decision to turn his ships around. And so at the end of these 13 days, he stops his plan to build nuclear weapons or nuclear weapon launching pads within Cuba, right? And so the world avoids a thermonuclear war. But we now, like I said, we now know this was as tense as any Cold War episode that we've experienced within the early decades of the Cold War. Okay, so those are the last events that I want to hit on. You're going to learn a little bit more, right? So just a real quick little review. What I kind of need you to kind of understand a little bit is the series of events, and if you want to pick sides, we could pick sides, right? So the first major one that we talked about was the Berlin airlift, right? Stalin's blockade, the United States and Great Britain respond by sending in planes and really winning the hearts of those people in West Germany. Stalin has to break down. But then the Soviet Union really picks up a couple wins, right? They got Sputnik in space first. They shoot down one of our spy planes. They put up the Berlin Wall. And so they are really kind of pushing us around a little bit. They got this communist revolution in Cuba. United States responds with force or with the threat of force in the Cuban Missile Crisis. And so we can kind of talk the fact that we got Khrushchev to back off and push things back a little bit. Maybe that's a little bit of a victory for us. But all of these events signify that tensions are extremely high between these Western European countries. And I'm focused, and I know we talked a lot about the United States efforts, but anything that we've been doing has the full backing of the great Britain, France, right? These NATO countries. So we're focusing on the European aspect within the Soviet Union. But, you know, if the United States goes to a nuclear war over Cuba with the Soviet Union, all of Europe is going to be impacted. Right. So we have these events. Okay. As you progress through in your readings, especially getting into next week, you're going to learn a little bit more about the rest of Western Europe. How are they advancing? Right? What is happening economically? What is happening socially? What is happening politically across Western Europe? How will that impact the Soviet Union? What is happening within the Soviet Union? Or more importantly, what is not happening within the Soviet Union? As the rest of Europe advances and really moves into the modern era, what is going on in the Soviet Union? Okay. The last thing I want to hit today, and I know we're going a little bit long, but I do think it's important for you to have a really good understanding of who the Soviet leaders are and in the proper order. If we go back, you should be able to tell me, the first Soviet leader, the man who leads the Russian Revolution, the first Mr. Worldwide, obviously, is our man, Vladimir Lenin. Remember, not John. Vladimir Lenin. We know that he stays in power for 7 years. Obviously, after Lenin dies, we now know that Joseph Stalin emerges. He takes the Soviet Union through World War II and in the early stages of our Cold War. After Stalin's death, we talked a little bit about Nikita Khrushchev. You're going to read some really important things about Khrushchev. Probably more important than him coming to Iowa, although I would say him making a visit to Coon Rapids, Iowa is pretty darn important. Khrushchev kind of is one of the first Soviet leaders to go against, well, he is the first leader after Stalin, but he acknowledges within the Soviet Union that maybe some of Joseph Stalin's practices, especially his harsh purges, his kind of ruling with an iron mustache or an iron fist, are not good. And so he goes through a period of de-Stalinization to try to make some early reforms within the Soviet Union. But don't push Khrushchev too far. You will read in your notes, when countries like Poland and Hungary see this concept of maybe some reforms as a way to really show their independence, Khrushchev is ready to crush them. There is no doubt that the leaders of the Soviet Union come from Russia. Russia is going to dominate the Warsaw Pact. And so he will rule with an iron fist if he needs to. Had we been in class, we'd talk a little bit about some of his really cool stories. He's got this great story where he's at the UN and he like just starts pounding the table anytime somebody starts talking up on the UN of things that rally or like criticizing communism. He just starts pounding the table like a child and doesn't want to listen. Like, Khrushchev cracks me up. Khrushchev dies in 1964. And really, we can maybe make a case that after 1964, things start to turn for the Western powers a little bit more. The next major Soviet leader is a man named Leonid Brezhnev. And Brezhnev will take us in the Cold War throughout the course of the 1960s up until the 1980s, through the 1970s. Brezhnev, right, will be the leader during periods of tense relationships within communism, especially the United States conflict in Southeast Asia, in Vietnam. But he'll also be a part of détente. You're going to learn a little bit about détente, the cooling off relationships between those. Brezhnev will sign two major nuclear arms reduction treaties. SALT is what they know, Strategic Arms Limitation Treaties. He kind of sees him and the President of the United States see this constant arms race as detrimental. So he's kind of an interesting character. He, Brezhnev, does start to recognize by the 1980s that the Soviet Union is starting to get drastically behind technologically wise, especially the economic vitality of his country compared to Western Europe. Brezhnev starts to recognize that we've got some issues within the Soviet Union. Then you get a series of leaders who really are just not good. The first man you get is Yuri Andropov. And then, as you can see, he only lasts about 2 years. And then he croaks, right? And then you get this other guy, Konstantin Chernenko, who really only rules for a year, maybe not so much a year. And to be honest with you, he may or may not have been dead for a long time before we really recognize if he was actually a living leader within the Soviet Union or not, right? So these two, what you get are some really poor leaders in a time of major crisis within the Soviet Union. You are going to read next week a little bit about that economic struggle within the Soviet Union. And what you get at a time of economic struggle are some really poor leaders who just cannot respond to it. Then the name that you are going to have to know inside and out, the last leader of the Soviet Union, is Mikhail Gorbachev. And as you can take note, he comes to power in 1985. Ronald Reagan is president of the United States. Margaret Thatcher is, you're going to read a little bit about her, a fascinating woman prime minister within Great Britain. Both Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher kind of ramp up the Cold War rhetoric to really test Mikhail Gorbachev. Mikhail Gorbachev will come to power at a time, like I said, where the Soviet Union is in some serious trouble. And he is going to step up and make some reforms, trying to keep the Soviet Union together. When you get into it, the thing I need you to understand about Mikhail Gorbachev is he is a communist, right? Sometimes we paint a picture of Gorbachev now as this man who really wanted to see the Soviet Union and communism end. That is not true. Gorbachev wanted to keep the Soviet Union together. He wants to keep communism as an economic power or as an economic tool within the Soviet Union, but he does recognize that some reforms have to be made. But when he makes those reforms, the people respond in a way that this is not enough, and he opens that door just a little bit, and the Russian and the Soviet people kind of knock that door wide open, and we'll talk a little bit about that next week into the fall of communism. So those are your communist leaders within the Soviet Union. Just to kind of wrap it up to show you how we got to where Russia is now, after the Soviet Union collapses, we get another hoot of a man, Boris Yeltsin, who rules the new Russia. This line is meant to signify, all right, these are your Soviet leaders. But when Gorbachev leaves, there is no more Soviet Union. And so now you get an elected leader, Boris Yeltsin. And after Boris Yeltsin begins the Vladimir Putin era. You should note on these years here, he comes in, the constitution of the Soviet Union is very similar to ours, that you can rule for 2 4-year terms. And so he does. He takes his 8 years and he leaves office. But this is where the Putin factor kicks in. Vladimir Putin handpicks his prime minister, Dmitry Medvedev, and through some Putin magic, lo and behold, hey, guess what? My man wins the election in a landslide. And so, while he is president, the first thing Medvedev does is name our man Vladimir Putin as his prime minister. As prime minister, Putin has the constitution manipulated, and now the constitution says that former presidents can now come in and run for president again. So, sorry Medvedev, you get your 4 years, and another election takes place, and our man Putin comes back. By the way, one of the earlier constitutional adjustments was not only can a former president become president again, he now has a 6-year term. If you've been paying any attention to current events, you will realize just within the last 2 or 3 months, Vladimir Putin has again adjusted the constitution. The government of Russia has resigned, a new government has come in, and they are now looking at ways to basically say the two six-year terms really don't mean anything, and now a president can continue to run. So who knows how long our Putin will stay in power. Okay, that's enough for today. Through all of those events, some cool things like Khrushchev coming to Iowa, some more important events like the Cuban Missile Crisis and brinkmanship, and then a little bit of a glimpse into what you are going to get into next week. I really need you, the best that you can, to try to stay. I'm going to come up on our reading calendar here, right? I think it's just good to stay in a routine, right? This isn't an overextension of your time. You've got the time on your hands. I think it's just a really good idea for closure to kind of finish off this unit. You're going to get into next week, especially readings number 7 and 8, and you're going to get into really the nuts and bolts information to help you answer the question, what led to the collapse of the Soviet communism, right? And then what do you think? Was containment responsible for it? So, with that, we'll let Mr. GQ Putin take us out. Hopefully you're all safe. I do miss y'all. I kind of miss our time in class together. Stay safe. Be nice to your parents. Be nice to your siblings. Take care.